Here it comes, here it comes.
Buddy, you're a boy, make a big noise, playing in the street, gonna be a big
man someday.
You got blood on your face, you big disgrace, kicking your can all over the place.
Here we go.
We will rock you.
Okay. What they're singing about there is rocking us, disturbing the normal circumstances, and offering an amazing experience. Here's what we're talking about today is we've had an amazing experience, and we're going to start having the results of that experience. Let's talk about Fukushima. Nuclear radiation from that facility. Oh, Andy, it wasn't the Japanese fault. They went to every safe measure. They didn't know they were going to have an earthquake and then a tsunami that would disrupt that plant that's built right on the ocean, right near an earthquake zone. How could you blame them for anything? I'm not. I'm just stating the facts. The facts are that in April, on April 11th, 2011, we had an event, a nuclear reactor, which actually had three reactors, experienced an earthquake. You see a picture of it there. It was a beautiful facility. It took 20 years to get it online, took billions of dollars, and it helped generate electricity for the Japanese people. Isn't that great? All noble causes. Next slide. Here's what happened. Look at the pictures on the top left. First, the tsunami came. You see that plume. It looked like something was burning a house. It got taller and taller and taller. And at the top of that plume was radioactive material. It was spread out everywhere. Another picture on the top right. That is how it looked on the day of and many days after. The magnitude of that earthquake was 6.6. We get those a lot out here. I'm not saying that's a minor one. We do know it. We're prepared for it. A 15 meter, what is that? 3 times 15. That's pretty good sized of a wave that came in and destroyed a lot of the capabilities of that facility. So 12 of the 13 backup generators stopped working. And what that did was that poured off cool water, the facility went offline, and then that core, that's where the nuclear material gets hot and it heats up water that runs a turbine that makes electricity, failed. So we had nuclear explosions inside those buildings. Next slide. Well, the name of the company that owns it is the Tokyo Electric Power Company. I'm sure they're all wonderful people, went to wonderful educations and had American, French, and German consultants. That's fine. What was their response? Now, they had a lot of people asking them what to do and telling them what to do, but all those reactors, as of last I've heard, have been shut down, but they're still going. That's the problem. Every reactor has its own branded form of radioactive material. In this case, it was cesium-137. It was released into the environment, went way up, miles up in the air, and the jet stream carried those radioactive isotopes wherever they're going. Also, as of right now, there's still Pacific seawater that's being pumped in there and then being pumped out into the ocean. What is the result of all of those facts? Next slide. Well, here is a satellite photo. It's actually a heat scanning photo. It's put out by a government agency that has looked at it. And what they're saying is, if you look at Japan, there's a plume of active radioactive heat there. Now, you might say, Andy, that's way on the other end of the world, X thousand miles away. Why should we ever be concerned? Next slide. Well, later on, another study in 2012 from a satellite that looked at seawater, radioactive seawater, and this is the vision they have. Now, does that frighten anybody here? Because the what they call the half-life of some of these radioactive isotopes is 250,000 years. That's how long it's going to be around. Yes, the potency of it will be reduced over time, but the issue is, look at how it spreads. Next slide. Is there any food danger? I thought you were supposed to be talking about food only. Well, radioactive isotopes don't distinguish between any type of life. What you see on the far left is the most obvious way to detect. Those detectors cost anywhere from $25,000 to $35,000 to $50,000. You see somebody over there in South Korea checking that fish, and they're coming up with what? Above average levels. Some levels are dangerous to humans to consume that fish. Also, in the middle shot, you will see a normal cabbage, which Japanese love, and an enlarged cabbage as a result of the damage of the DNA. That's what radioactivity does. It damages the DNA. I've been working with DNA for quite a while. If it's not intact, you can intentionally make the DNA change to make that product larger, but that is actually an undetermined deformation. It's a mutant. On the right-hand side, you'll see it also a mutant ear of corn. If you really study it, you'll see it has many irregularities. It's not designed to come out with two potential ears. On the right-hand side, you'll see a scientist holding a cucumber, which has a very disturbing deformation, malformation, and a mutant situation. Nobody's going to eat that, or they shouldn't, because the radioactivity may be resident inside the product itself. So what we're talking about is 300 tons of contaminated water every day being pumped out to the sea just to keep that from going thermonuclear, in other words, blowing up and going down into the core of the Earth. If you take off that cold water, it will. It will increase in heat and have a reaction potentially. So the aerial dispersion through the jet stream, and then you have it going through the seabed. So the maximum levels may even be in the drinking water, which is terribly obvious at that point. Everything there is being affected by cesium-137. Next slide. Well, Andy, it's never happened before. Really. Let's look at the facts. United States had what's known as the Manhattan Project, generated two weapons, actually more, tested it before. But the events that everybody hears about, 1945, they say it stopped the Japanese. Hiroshima and Nagasaki. After Hiroshima, the Japanese didn't understand what happened. The United States said, surrender now or do it again. They did it again. But the United States wasn't happy. We need to know all the effects of nuclear weapons. So what they had was desert rock. That's out in the deserts of Nevada. From 1951 to 1967, X number of atomic devices were unleashed both above ground, atmospheric, that means higher than the air, and then beneath the ground. As a result of that, we had a lot of our troops exposed to these detonations. Some of them didn't have any protection at all while the scientists sat in big bunkers. What's the issue there? We've had a lot of studies on cancer cases and other types of maladies as a result of those experiments. Three Mile Island was an unintentional experiment on a nuclear reactor. Very similar circumstances. That whole area has, since 1979, has been prohibited from humans returning there. But you and I, if we tried to buy a house in Nagasaki or in Hiroshima today, we couldn't afford it. Those houses cost a lot of money. It's not comparable to human housing in the United States. Chernobyl, if anybody doesn't know about that, that was an actual detonation which the device actually blew up. That area, huge areas of the Ukraine have been prohibited. They've done studies on the animals and the humans that have died from cancer. There are different types of cancer challenges. One of them, look at that gentleman in the bottom left and look hard. That's what they call direct effect, where the radiation is directly affecting the body. Now we have continuing harm. Look at that little child there. They could have a number of maladies. Birth defects were very common. Those are Russian Ukrainians. And look at that child. Don't look at it very long. It's very disturbing. But even here in the United States, we have many of our troops that were in that 67 campaign that are suffering from cancer. Many people in that area, particularly in Utah, because that's where the winds flew. What I'm saying to you, radiation causes harm. Immediate and long term. Next slide. All right, here are my suggestions. Number one, in all the information I've looked at, say, Andy, don't get too concerned. It'll be okay. I have a challenge with that. Because even with the Fukushima experience, if you look that up on the internet, not all the facts were given out right away. If you look on Chernobyl, the Russians didn't let everybody know their challenges right away and tell us about the cloud that settled over Europe, still affecting people, their cancer cases are exponential. They also didn't tell us about these 67, from 51 to 67 experiments. They didn't tell us all the effects of Three Mile Island. It took congressmen filing laws to get those facts revealed. So we need, here are my suggestions for you. Look at on the left, that graphic. You can ingest it, in other words, you can breathe it in, inhalation. You can eat it. You can have it come to you in any different ways. You can't see it or smell it. And by the way, it's not plutonium, not like a weapon. Those are weaponized particulates. You probably cannot afford to buy one of those radiometers to detect a level, to give you a number, to say, oh, I'm sick because of this. But what you can do is limit your ingestion of seafood products from that plume. Plume means it has a source, it goes out, it's dispersed, and other animals will ingest it. And if you eat that animal, let's say a fish goes around for 100 miles, and then somebody catches that fish, it has collected all those isotopes. So when you eat the fish, you're eating a concentrated source sample. So you need to monitor the local reports of cesium-137. And we can actually track it back to those three reactors. So every reactor has a specific chemical formulae. Get a regular health checkup. And while you're there, just ask about radioactive cases in the area. If you get it, it's going to be a challenge. Some people have gone to hoarding iodine, which helps, into your thyroid gland. I would not be particularly worried about food that's grown in California. You say, oh, Andy, you already told me that that jet stream brings it right on top of it. That might be a concern. But you might say, oh, Andy, we've had a history of cancer in my family, or we haven't had a history of cancer, and I've got it now. Should I be worried? And you can't be suing the Japanese. It's not going to happen. Take care of yourself. Keep a close watch on yourself. Do not allow things to rock your world unnecessarily. This is something we can't protect ourselves from. But from the bottom of my heart, I would wish you to not cut back on your food consumption from that area of direct contamination. Thank you very much. Look forward to the next segment.